What is more difficult than growing up from a very powerful father? In China, we say 富二代, is actually to fight the intellectual challenges that are in your head. And today I'm gonna talk about this. So, please work with me. Let's think about the Earth, our planet Earth, our Earth as a whole. And tomorrow, you know, there's a day dedicated to it. Okay, no, it's actually on April 22nd was the Earth Day. This year, 175 nations came together in a great room in the UN's General Assembly Hall. And I watched while sitting on the balcony, a little bit above this picture, you cannot see it, watching them signing the Paris Agreement. There's a really hard to explain feeling in the room. It is great, there's no denial that climate change is happening. But after my participation in about five COP climate negotiations, to celebrate, it's really, really difficult. Because this plan, what will it do? It promises to keep the Earth cool, not warmer than 1.5 degrees. And what does that mean? So in that room, all these questions are popping up in my head. Can we really do it? Finance, technological transfer, are these enough? Coming back a little bit on a lighter note, I want to tell you that being a climate scientist is even more unloved than being a weatherman. Because there's really never good weather in their climate prediction models. And it's always you always have a chance of getting it wrong. Because when someone asks you, doctor, professor, how warm will our planet be if we continue to live like this in 100 years? 3 degrees? 3.5 degrees? 6 degrees? 15 degrees? We don't know. Because, after all, climate models are only representations. They are at best fuzzy. And we know that our planet is more than a system of forces. It is a lot more complex. It is like an organism, and we simply just don't have the language to describe it. Currently, we can only rely on complex charts like these. This is made by McKinsey Consulting Company with a bunch of top scientists several years back, and explains to you from this side, investing in PV, to this side, investing in energy efficiency in buildings such as insulation, and home appliances, and how much it costs, and how much it saves. But I'm worried is that this type of thinking puts us in narrow categories, produces in lots of experts, and probably has already put every one of you texters off. So we need something better to guide us if we need to move forward together and join this climate, or even just to build a better human habitat together. The specialized way of thinking championed by the Cartesian Newtonian paradigm has a history. It came about not because it's a natural way of thinking. It came about because it is good at doing certain things, such as ballistic missiles and human anatomy dissection. But for our Earth as a whole, it does not fit into any of these narrow paradigm scientific thinking. We need something more. And I have my own theories, my own bias to believe that this way of thinking was probably reached its height in time of war, that monarchs have to sacrifice everything in terms of quality and gear a whole nation towards the destruction of their enemies. But to maintain in the relative state of peace as we have today, we need a new breed of thinkers that are capable of grasping the whole. And the whole is probably very difficult to produce from the specialized employment, specialized education. We used to learn that in our daily life. We used to learn that in our cities. But we are so good at specialization, so we have transformed all of that. So where can we find thinkers that are capable of thinking the otherwise? Goethe, you can call him a scientist to some people, but he's best known for his poetry and his writings. And in Faust, he left us a warning. He said that if we cut living things to pieces, and we will lose the truth. Where will we find a different way of thinking? Maybe let's ask the quantum physicists. If you have ever hung out with some quantum physicists, you will know that they are the smartest people. And one of the greatest of them is David Bohm. And David Bohm said something like this, I paraphrase, that fragmentation is not real. Wholeness is real. And we have to begin from wholeness and never to resort back to fragmentation. I think that fragmentation has taken us a very long way. Specialization has taken us to the door of quantum physics, to the door of ecology, of the theory of mind, but really to grab the key, to open it, and that is wholeness. And that will not only open us to science, but actually also to our whole situation of living on Earth. So we desperately need a shift in our thinking. When I graduated from Carnegie Mellon as an architect, I brought away rulers. But later on, I discovered they're not really satisfying to work with because they're good at cutting things into small pieces, again, leading to fragmentation. So I dreamed and I hoped there was this set of tools that I can use, that a new type of measure which are prevented from producing fragmentations. And every time it measures, every time it takes measure, it produces wholeness. Is that possible? 此刻，请大家转换您的语言接收模式，因为我相信中文其实是一个更好能来捕捉我所刚刚在讲座的整体性的一个观念。 I believe Chinese is more accompanying to the description and understanding of wholeness. That's my bias. 所以我将继续用中文来完成六个尺度的一个解释，它如何来丈量我们的地球，而且我认为这不只是建筑师需要知道的，因为每一个人多多少少都希望主宰自己的空间。用一句话概括，用情感掺入社区的建造。 使言语的次序叙述人的习性。这六个尺度，我给了他一些名字，可以用六个中文字来描述。我就开始。第一个尺度，情感。那些在地球上意义特别深刻的一些地方，就比如说布达拉宫，或者是一个充满生命的花园，你要是 看进去，你一定会发现，那里都存在情感，是建造师用自己的情感去丈量这整栋建筑而完成的。对比主义，这一个地方离上海不太远，有谁认识吗？它是以主义产生的一个成果，但是从表面上看，你会觉得它是整体的。 但是你真正的深入看进去，它却是分裂的，而人的情感在这里被分解的支离破碎，排除的干干净净。所以以主义所创造出来的东西，它可以变成某个人的专利，但是它不会像是以情感所创造出来的东西，它是那么的整体。 社区里的使用者是否能参与到城市的这个建造当中去？我们可否想象，政府、建筑师、建造商 都逐渐转换成为整体性的促进者，而对比那种以上帝之手控制垄断生产出来的城市，它是那么的没有活力，那么的失败。而我在柏林，在印度进行我的博士论文的时候，我在写的主题是城市的政策与气候变化。我发现如果人可以主宰自己的空间的时候，其实它有一种趋向整体性的发展，它更加像一种生物的涌现的一种状态。建造建筑的环境成本实在是太大了，它占有我们地球上50%的资源，使用地球50%的能源，间接与直接的。那么建造应该是不断一次一次变得更好，前一栋建筑的问题被后一栋建筑解决，而不是用今天的这种复制的方式生产。我们有一个模型，以最低价的方式专项把它分解，然后去生产。在过去的7年，我的父亲，我非常崇拜他，他可以专专心心的就干这么一件事情，去研究新的建造模式，新的专利。前段时间我了解，他原来有2000多个关于环境保护能源效率的专利。他之前是一个艺术家，其实我最崇拜他的并不是他的成功，而是说他怎么样子可以是一个艺术家，同时又可以是一个科学家，这是最让我纳闷的事情。他对于建筑，对于技术的期待，就是建筑可以成为一个让人类栖息地不断完善区域整体的一个方式。这当然是一个很漫长的路。语言是承载我们过去的记忆，有很长长的历史，比如说拱门、窗户，还有长廊，在语言中间储存了人类栖息地长久的这个智慧。而如果我们把语言分解成专项的术语的话，它就会变成这样子的属于粗糙的一种符号，然后专家一些势力把这些符号喂给我们，然后我们觉得永远不可以满足，是因为我们没有得到那个真实整体的东西，所以我们不断要的越来越多，而越来越多就造成了越来越多的浪费。秩序，英国田园的景观其实是一个非常人造的一个产物，是经过多少代人不断的呵护，一步一步走向更加整体的一个局势，一个形态。而对比土地模式使用的这种变迁，你知道30%的碳排放来自于我们的这样子的行为吗？从自然变成农业，从农业再变成城市，从城市再变成工业。如果我们相信地球是一个整体的话，那哪怕破坏一个地方的美，也会影响它的整体。所以我们如果敢想象把秩序、把美纳入新的人类栖息地的科学中的话，那你想结果会是多好呢？ Habit makes habitat， 什么样的习性就造就什么样的栖息地。我分享一个中国古代的故事，庄子寓言中鲁侯养鸟的故事。鲁国的国君看到一只海鸟，把它请回到了宫殿，然后在这个宫殿里呢，给它献上了这种山珍美味、山珍海味，然后呢又给它奏乐，结果不过3天，这只鸟因为惊吓过度而死了。其实这样的事情在我们的栖息地里面是天天发生的，我们现在的栖息地是趋于一种机械的习惯，而非一种整体自然的习惯。在曼哈顿的这个 Bryant Park 里面，人 与整个环境都行为一个整体，因为生命不是孤立的，它是与它的环境形成一个整体。看看这只鸭子，有谁看到兔子的请给我举个手。看到了吗？我所说的一切的确是很困难，但是有人用这个来描述模式转变的可能性，就是一旦你看到那只白兔子，你就再也不会忘记它了。最终我们需要扩充我们的科学观，我们需要容纳多种模式，不管是分解的还是整体性的。你知道围棋它每一步都是会决定整体棋盘的这个命运吗？所以说一个选手他每一步都是对一个整体的沉思，而这种美它其实是非常高层次的，这种思考，而这种美一定是下一个模式转变。谢谢。